Well, welcome to Ombuds Day 2019. We're so thrilled to host this event. Thank you for making it through the snowstorm. I'm Kiersey Aline. I'm the director of the Ombuds office here at CU Boulder. And we've had so much support from our university for this event. We're very grateful for that, as well as many of our sponsors who are here, for instance, Pfizer. We are so thrilled to have Ken Cloak here today, and Anna Spain Bradley, who is one of our law school professors and a vice provost, will introduce him. Thank you.
Well, good evening. I am so excited to see that you guys made it out in this frosty, cold first snow of the season day. And I'm sure that you'd rather be home under a blanket somewhere.
No, so it's Ombudsman Day.
But it's Ombudsman Day. We have to celebrate. So it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, but I also want to first give a huge thank you to Liz Hill, who's the Associate Director of our Ombuds office. Thank you for making today possible. And, you know, as a way of introducing our distinguished guest, to say, how many of you in the last month have had an argument? The last week? The last 48 hours? And in that painful moment, you might have thought to yourself, if only there was someone who could help me with this. And there is. And his name is Dr. Kenneth Cloak. And we are so fortunate to have him all the way from Los Angeles, California, here today to share insights on his newest book, The Politics, Dialogue, and Evolution of Democracy, How to Discuss. Ken Cloak is somebody who has been a leader in the field of conflict resolution, of mediation, of civil rights, of civil protest for decades. And I was fortunate to meet him back in LA in 2004 or 5 when I was a student in his mediation class, along with lots of other people who were at a crossroads in our life and needed a bit of inspiration. And Ken has an infallible sense of hope that comes not from a sense of blindness to what's happening in this world, but from deep engagement with what's happening in this world. And it just takes one look at the news to see we are at a crossroads in our common global community. So Ken comes to us as a doctor, a PhD, as an attorney, as a mediator, with an LLM and lots of other things. He's authored many books. He has founded Mediators Beyond Borders International, and he has served as a leader and a symbol for who humanity can be at its best. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ken Cloak.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Anna. First of all, thank you to Liz, wherever you are. Not here, out helping to make this happen, and to the Ombuds office here at the University of Colorado, and all the Ombuds everywhere. What I'm going to try to do today is something that is going to be quite difficult and perhaps even impossible. We're going to try to tackle a major topic and to think about it in new ways. And the topic is one that touches all of our lives, as Anna was just saying. I think everyone here knows that we are in a kind of crisis, a political crisis, here in the United States and around the world. That crisis touches each of us uniquely in a variety of ways. The crisis is right now about impeachment, but it's also about race, and it's about gender, and it's about equality, and it's about migration and gun control and all of these things. And what's characteristic of these things is, in the first place, that there are conflicts that are taking place around them. And yet, what we also see is that conflict resolution professionals, mediators, collaborative negotiators, ombudspeople around the world, have had very little to say about these conflicts. Why? I think because we don't know exactly how to tackle them, because it's too easy to get sucked into a hostile, adversarial, win-lose conversation that we know is going to end badly. So what's wrong with this picture? Well, what I'd like to do is to describe the way that I've been trying to think about it from a mediation point of view, and to bring interest-based ideas into a conversation about politics. In the first place, simply because this is what we do professionally, but more importantly, vastly more importantly, because this is actually going to impact our lives, the lives of our children, and our children's children. We are facing issues with regard to climate change, and those are going to increase the intensity and the scope of these conflicts. And so we need to have some method of handling them. But what I'd like to suggest is that that methodology is actually going to be helpful to each and every one of us in the work that we are doing in our lives as ombudspeople, as mediators, collaborative negotiators, conflict resolvers of various types. So what is this really about? The title is Conflict Revolution. I hope you like the title. I spray painted that on myself. What I think we need to consider is how conflict resolution has grown incrementally in small pieces over, in my experience, the last four decades. But what would a critical mass look like? What would happen if we were actually able to use these conflict resolution skills with regard to deeper, more fundamental problems in our lives, including the ones that ombudspeople deal with all the time? And that fundamentally has to do with designing preventative systems for all kinds of conflicts. Now, let me just take a step back and say something different. Where are conflicts located? Rather simple question, but I think we can see immediately that there are three clear answers. First, inside of each of us. And if a conflict is located inside of us, what are the methodologies, the techniques, the ways of approaching it that are going to make a difference? Well, psychology and various forms of emotional therapy are one way of handling it. Conflict coaching is another way of handling it. Second, and there are some other ways, but I won't go into those now. A second place that conflicts are located is between us. That is, they are internal and they are relational. And we have methods for handling conflicts when they are relational. Those are about conversations, designing conversations that are going to be helpful and turn people in the direction of collaborative problem solving. But a third place where conflicts arise is systemically. That is, conflicts exist not only inside of us and between us, but also in the systems that we operate in. And one way of describing systemic conflicts is to say that they are chronic in nature, meaning they don't just happen once. The whole purpose of a system, what a system is a method of generating, of self-generation. But if the system is organized around a conflict, what gets self-generated is also the conflict. Because in many cases, it is precisely the conflict that is holding the system together. And if you don't realize that, take a look at a lot of marriages. Take a look at a lot of families, because it's identical on all these levels. We can say that conflict is, if you want to use a scientific term, is fractally organized, meaning it is self-similar on all scales. So there is something similar in the conflicts between two kids on a playground and the heads of nation states. What is similar? Well, number one, each one thinks they're right and the other one is wrong. Number two, everybody's having an emotional response to this, and that emotional response is triggering a set of adversarial assumptions and aggressive and hostile behaviors. And so the question is the same thing happening in politics? And the answer, of course, is yes. We see it all the time. You can't look at a newspaper today without seeing this in actual operation. So the question really is there an alternative to this way of doing things? And that's why I wrote this book, to figure out, is there an alternative, and if so, what would it consist of? So let's actually start by taking a look. That's the book, which is outside, and this is Robin Short, who is the publisher of the book with Good Media Press from Dallas. Amos Oz, who is a novelist from Israel, he says, the fact is that all the power in the world cannot transform someone who hates you into someone who likes you. It can turn a foe into a slave, but not into a friend. All the power in the world cannot transform a fanatic into an enlightened man. All the power in the world cannot transform someone thirsting for vengeance into a lover. And yet, such transformations happen. How many of you are active mediators or conflict resolvers? Okay, so raise your hand if you have had an experience of adversaries all of a sudden dropping their adversarial behavior and having a really good, constructive, caring conversation. Raise your hand. Okay, way too many hands went up. Okay, what does that mean? It means there is something in this process that is connecting people at a level beneath the level of power. Second, Desmond Tutu. If you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse and you say that you are neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality. Okay, what does this mean? It means that there is another way of thinking that we have to gravitate towards. Neutrality is the language of the law, and it comes out of the law precisely because the judge has power. I speak as a former judge myself, and the judge has power. And if the judge has power, the judge has to suppress their inherent biases and prejudices, at least that's what they think. And they think that simply by denying those and appearing to be neutral, they are then able to perform their function more effectively. But of course, the most biased person in the world is the one who doesn't acknowledge their bias. What we do as mediators and ombudspeople and conflict resolvers is very different, which is we have a position of that is without power, but of course it is precisely our powerlessness that gives us power, okay? Because we don't have to be neutral. What that means is we can be what I call omnipartial, or on everybody's side at the same time. And isn't that what we want? On the one hand, what we want is for whoever we are dealing with not to be prejudiced against us. That is, what that means in a sense is to see you as who you actually are. But it turns out this is not so easy, to see people as they actually are. And to become who you actually are is in a way much more difficult. And what is necessary in order to be able to do that is not neutrality. It is actually caring and a recognition that diversity is actually a gift. It is a gift to you because it allows you to become more yourself, more who you actually are, and skip the traces of conformity, if I can put it that way. And Martin Luther King Jr., our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. Now, what are these three quotes, what are they pointing us towards? And the first quote by Amos Oz is from a book that he wrote, which is about zealotry. And we have zealots in lots of different places. It is very easy to become a zealot, even about conflict resolution. And what we need to do is to take a step back at this and look at what the sources of this are. So you were going to confront, as ombudspeople in universities, for corporations, for institutions, as mediators, you're going to be confronting conflict, not just in its psychological dimension and not just in its relational dimension. You will be confronting systems. And whenever you are confronting systems that are generating chronic conflicts, power will be an issue for you. And that's family systems, it's neighborhood and community systems, it's organizational systems, social systems, political systems, economic systems. Now, within conflict resolution, we have a critique of power. And what I want to do is to try to introduce that critique in a way that takes us back to something that's important. To start with, here are some of the things that I think we know about mediation in politics. We've all watched political conversations degenerate into shouting matches. Political conversations matter because they're about our future, our lives, our values. Successful political decision making requires not silence or pointless rage, but dialogue, not apathy or aggression, but collaborative negotiation. There is nothing about our political system that encourages or promotes this type of approach to conversation. But I think that we will find that it is at the very core of what politics actually is. So I'm not going to go through these. The slides will be available for anybody. Let's see, we were going to put up Liz was.
There's a sign right outside.
There's a little sign right outside the door. You can get the email link, and these slides will be available for you. Once you do that, they belong to you. They are yours. Steal them, okay? Mm-hmm. Use them however you want. So the question at the very bottom, well, the two up from the bottom, politics has been called the art of compromise. But what if instead it's the art of conflict resolution, in which compromise is simply a small piece, one option out of many? And then we have to ask, what would a mediative, interest-based form of conflict resolution, of politics, look like? What skills do we need in order for democracy to work? And my belief is, this is one of them. The skills that you have is one of the skills everybody needs in order for politics to work, in order for democracy to work. And I'll try to explain why. Here are two quotes. One is from Larry Susskind, who was at MIT and the head of a major contributor to conflict resolution, and the head of something called the Consensus Building Institute, author of many major articles and pieces about conflict resolution, talking about neutrality as central to the values. And we have to be careful about our entering into the political field. On the other hand, we have Bernie Mayer, whose name you can't see at the bottom, who wrote a book arguing against neutrality. That's the title of his book, and saying that instead what we have to do is we have to become active as citizens and express our values openly. So who's right? And I think that the answer is both and neither. Because what we haven't really done is to take a deep dive into what politics actually consists of and think about it as mediators from scratch. So that's what we want to start with, how to think about politics. So here's Václav Havel, former head of Czechoslovakia and the Czech Republic. Genuine politics, politics worthy of the name, and the only politics I am willing to devote myself to, is simply a matter of serving those around us, serving the community and serving those who will come after us. Its deepest roots are moral, because it is a responsibility. There's only one way to strive for decency, reason, responsibility, sincerity, civility, and tolerance, and that is decently, reasonably, etc. But I'm aware that in everyday politics, this is not seen as the most practical way of doing it. Okay, so let's come to terms with this. What are some classical purposes of politics? Actually, let me stop here for a second and just say this. The very first writings that we encounter about politics, the very first serious, thoughtful examination of what politics are, take place with Plato and Aristotle and Socrates about 2,500 years ago. So it's worthwhile going back and taking a look at what Aristotle actually wrote in the Politics. And let me give you what he actually wrote. Here's a quote from Aristotle. Every state is a community of some kind, and every community is established with a view to some good. For mankind always act in order to obtain that which they think good. But if all communities aim at some good, the state or political community, which is the highest of all, and which embraces all the rest, aims, and in a greater degree than any other, at the highest good. So Aristotle's definition of politics is, in quotes, a search for the highest common good. What's wrong with that? Well, the answer is nothing, except it doesn't describe what we experience every day in a political arena. So what is missing in Aristotle's analysis that would help us predict what we have today? And the answer is this. Very soon after writing this, a page or two, Aristotle goes on to say, of course, none of this applies to women, children, slaves, or barbarians. Right? Meaning about 80% of the population of Athens is excluded from the democracy that he is describing. And he goes further and says, there are some people who deserve to be slaves. Okay? In other words, slavery is a natural condition of inferiority. And now what we can see is that we have two definitions of politics. Definition number one, a search for the highest common good. And definition number two, a form of domination and a way of continuing that domination. Because clearly, if you have the slave participating in voting on whether to have slavery, slavery is not going to last very long. And so it is in the interest of slave owners, on the one hand, to have a democracy among themselves so as to have some mass support for slavery as an institution, and second, to exclude the slave from all forms of conversation about slavery. Indeed, therefore, all conversations in general, because the fundamental, you know, the motor of Athenian society was actually slavery. So, and by barbarians, of course, he means immigrants. So immigrants are excluded, slaves are excluded, women and children are excluded. Let's go back a step. Aristotle also says the purpose of politics is to provide for the general welfare. But once again, there are certain people whose general welfare or who are included in the general welfare, and there are other people who are excluded. So now politics becomes a question of who is excluded. The general welfare part is something that has positive connotations, whereas the exclusion and the domination, the superiority of men over women, of masters over slaves, etc., is something that is going to predictably create chronic conflicts in any society in which it arises. And what form will those chronic conflicts take? Well, because of the fact that Aristotle he's actually already given us the rationale, which is they don't deserve to participate in politics because they're not up to it. They are naturally inferior and therefore deserve to be dominated. And this is, of course, the argument of every form of domination, fundamentally. And it is inferiority not based on individual characteristics. The whole point of this is it is a group individual inferiority. It's something that characterizes every member of the group and therefore is a stereotype, and there is bias and discrimination and prejudgment that follow from the necessity for domination. And of course, we're talking about quite a lot of money being bound up in slaves, quite a lot of money being bound up in preventing slaves from running away, keeping women subordinated, etc. Aristotle also said to make sure that laws are fairly conceived, wisely interpreted, and justly enforced. Once again, we can see a positive part of this, but a part of what he is describing is something that took place right around the time of the Athenian state, but really took place afterwards in Rome. But you can see it if you watch, if you want to have a classic description of it, which is the rise of the neutral state, as something that takes place during this period of time, the ostensibly neutral state. It's still male dominated, it's still patriarchal, it's still a slave owner state, it still discriminates against people who are non-Athenians, but it is neutral in the sense that it professes to have objective standards that it is following in order to solve problems and do the work of government. The difficulty is that these objective standards are designed to conceal a subjective truth. The judge is going to be a white, male, slave-owning, adult, non-immigrant, always. Now, what you can then do is you can say, we're going to try to act in a non-prejudicial way, but the reality is that your subjective experience is going to, you know, sort of skew the way that you see things. And that's the way it is always and everywhere, in every society. Who you are, how you grew up, whether you came from a large family or a small family, whether you were born on a farm or in the city, those are all things that impact the way that we think and feel. But notice that a part of what this does is it creates a kind of objectivity that also is a denial of subjectivity. Now, today we are talking a great deal about emotional intelligence and the importance of emotional intelligence. But a part of the purpose of creating an objective standard is to devalue the way that women think, and to devalue men who think also in that similar way, that is not just think, but feel. Because if you are feeling instead of thinking, when you come up against a real human being, it's very difficult to slip back into that category, to consider them as a stereotype, because you've got a real human being now in front of you. And that is, of course, exactly what we do in conflict resolution. We invite the human being who is behind the conflict to come forward, not the adversarial mask that they have put on in order to gain something, but the reasons why that's important to them, what they, how they feel about each other. That is inherently an anti-patriarchal project, it seems to me. Now, Socrates, the purpose of politics is to make the citizen as good as possible. What does that mean? Socrates says basically politics is about collaborating with our neighbors, working together as a society, trying to solve our problems together, building community, figuring out how to get along with each other. And those are elements of virtue. And therefore, politics is designed to make the citizen more virtuous. Once again, it doesn't do that. And it doesn't do it because what has been planted within politics as a seed is its use through power as a way of dominating someone else. The neutrality is exactly the kind described by Desmond Tutu. Okay. So there are others as well, but now let's skip ahead and take a look at something different. This is also from Aristotle. I'm not going to spend much time on it, but what I want to do is I want to suggest that in conflict resolution, we can take Aristotle's basic categories of logic and critique them and show that actually they don't work so well. So a law of identity, a statement is what it is, A is identical to A, yet there are times when A is not identical to A. For example, calls to support our soldiers or be tough on criminals can actually mask calls to war or discriminatory social policies. The law of non-contradiction. A statement and its contradiction cannot be both be true. And yet, we know that there are times when they are. If you're married, you are living a kind of contradiction because somebody, as I was saying earlier, somebody likes to spend money and somebody likes to save it. Somebody likes to be on time and somebody else doesn't mind being a half an hour late, etc. So we are living with another real live human being. And this is not easy, okay? We all know this. And one of the reasons why it isn't easy is because we don't know how to handle our contradictory desires. We don't know how to talk about them effectively. So what do? We blow up, we throw a fit, we yell and scream, we storm out, we do all of those things. And as physicist Niels Bohr writes, these are in fact complementarities. And he defined a complementarity as a great truth whose opposite is also a great truth. So which is true, being on time or being late? Which is right? They're both right under different circumstances, for different people, for different reasons. There isn't a single correct answer. So now let's take a sidestep. And I'll just give you a very simple way of thinking of this. There are three orders of questions that I can ask this group. Order number one, who is the youngest or the oldest person in the group? I'm probably the oldest, you're probably the youngest. Who is the tallest and who is the shortest? The answer, there will be a single correct answer to this question for everyone in the group. Order number two, how old are you? How tall are you? Now there is a single correct answer for each individual person and no single correct answer for the group as a whole. Order of question number three. What does your age mean to you? What conflicts are you experiencing at whatever age you are at? How has your life changed at various ages? What does your height mean to you? Whatever those might happen to be. And now we have multiple correct answers for each individual person. Which is the most interesting question to talk about? Obviously, it's number three. Question number one, you take care of that pretty easily. And there are issues for which, you know, question number one is the appropriate question, and question number two. But when we come to relationships, when we come to emotion, when we come to internal conflicts, and even when we come to systemic conflicts, we have to have a higher order of skill at being able to ask questions that do not have a single correct answer. But this is everything that is taught in law school about how to be a lawyer. This is the, you all have heard this phrase, never ask a question you don't already know the answer to. But what's the point of that? There's no fun in that. The fun comes in actually asking a question you have no idea what the answer to it is. A question that actually, the answer is the human being who is in front of you, as complex as that human being is. Otherwise, we are putting round objects in square holes. We are reducing human beings to categories. And this is what happens in politics, and it's what happens in bureaucracy. And it is what conflict resolution is, as a field, is trying to escape. And it's one of the reasons why we're successful. We get to ask people, you know, what is it that you really care about each other? What kind of relationship would you like to have with each other? Why is that important to you? What does this mean to you? Why do you feel so passionately about this issue? Right? Those are the kinds of questions for which we have no idea what the answer is until the person actually speaks it. And therefore, prediction, control, all of the projects of trying to create something that is safe because it is bottling up an underlying effort to dominate or to win exclusively, just you. Now, if we look at the world today, we will see that fundamentally, all around the world, we are facing this choice, whether it's regard to immigration, whether it's regard to race or gender or climate change or any number of other things. It can be about what was, you know, the conversation at the United Nations about globalization versus nationalism. The issue is fundamentally simple. When scarcity begins to impact resources, what are you going to do? Look out for number one or take care of each other? And that's fundamentally what we're talking about. We are talking about caring about each other, about creating a conversation and a set of relationships and systems that do not require that somebody suppress who they are and what they want in order to be able to have their problems solved. Now, let's go a little further. Oh, the last one, the law of the excluded middle. This is the one that Aristotle is really famous for. But the excluded middle is exactly what we are talking about in conflict resolution. A statement is either true or false, cannot be true and false at the same time. Yet there are examples when things are true and false at the same time. Stories political opponents tell about themselves and each other can be true and false at the same time. We have lots of examples of this. Now, what is the idea of it not being able to be true and false at the same time? The object is, if I can put it this way, to overcome a conflict by choosing one side and saying that that side is correct, by setting a set of categories and saying, according to these categories and looking at the facts, this is the outcome, and this is the project of the law. It is to do precisely this. But notice, the law is therefore a conflict resolution mechanism, the whole of it. So are organizations. Every organization that you work for is a conflict resolution mechanism. That's its purpose, to bring people together so that they can do something commonly, collectively. But now, if we talk about this middle, there's a trick here. And the trick is this. There are two middles and not one. Okay? So here's how. How do you combine things together? Two ways. One, you take hot water and cold water and mix them together and you get lukewarm water. That's compromise. That is mediation in the classical sense, finding the middle. But there's a higher middle. And the higher middle is created when you take water and mix in flour and heat and make bread. And the bread has nothing in common with the water or the flour or the heat. Ostensibly, it's something new that was created out of the conversation, if you will, between the flour and the water and the heat. And so what we are trying to do in conflict resolution is not just create lukewarm water, we're trying to make bread. How do we do that? The answer is by opening up the conversations between people that we cannot predict where they're going to go. By inviting people to be present as themselves. By giving up the project of domination. By working diligently to shift people's attitudes towards one another by introducing themselves to who that person actually is. And one of the reasons why we have racism and sexism and homophobia and all of these other things is because that very separation, that very prejudice, that very stereotyping and discrimination exist in every conflict because it's exactly how you think of your opponent. Correct? Meaning, who here doesn't stereotype their opponent? Of course you do. What does that mean? It means you don't pay attention to the full human being who's there. Instead, you identify a characteristic of that person and collapse the person into the characteristic. So, what do we do? Well, these are some of the things it seems to me that are wrong with politics as usual. I'm not going to go through them. You know them all. Takes too long, costs too much, ineffective in solving global problems, controlled by wealthy individuals and special interests, grounded in domination, slips easily into autocracy, etc. All of these various things. Here's what Isaiah Berlin writes. And Isaiah Berlin was a professor at Oxford who is quite brilliant, wrote a number of different books. He's mostly known for something that he wrote called The Hedgehog and the Fox. I don't know if anyone, really great treatment of literature. He says, so long as only one ideal is the true goal, it will always seem to men that no means can be too difficult, no price too high to do whatever is required to realize the ultimate goal. Such certainty is one of the great justifications of fanaticism, compulsion, persecution. If there is only one solution to the puzzle, then the only problems are first how to find it, then how to realize it, and finally how to convert others to the solution by persuasion or by force. But if this is not so, then the path is open to empiricism, pluralism, tolerance, compromise. Tolerance is historically the product of the realization of the irreconcilability of equally dogmatic faiths and the practical improbability of complete victory of one over the other. Those who wished to survive realized that they had to tolerate error. They gradually came to see the merits of diversity and so became skeptical about definitive solutions in human affairs. It seems to me that underlying a great deal of political antagonism is this idea that there is a single correct solution to problems. And once again, sometimes that is in fact the case. There may in fact be problems for which there is a single correct solution. I would define those using a mathematical term as trivial. The interesting problems, the political problems, if you will, using politics now in the sense of Aristotle's first definition, are the ones that are that can't be reduced to that single correct answer. So, how do we define politics from an interest-based point of view? First of all, let me take a step back. Does everybody understand the probably not, I better stop and explain this, the distinction between power, rights, and interests? Fundamentally, it's this, and it comes out of, you can find it in Fisher and Urey and a variety of different books that have been written about this problem, but I think it's a very, very useful distinction. So there are three ways of deciding what's going to happen when you disagree in a family, in an organization, in a neighborhood, politically, socially, economically. Number one, the biggest, baddest, meanest person wins. Okay? So if we were to say right now, we're going to assume that there's an air conditioning unit that is on in this room. And this half the room wants the air conditioning off, and this half wants it on. How do we decide this? The air conditioning unit is either on or off. Way more people on this side, they'll beat up the people on this side and get their way, okay? Or the people on this side have more guns, more money, they get to beat up the people on this side and get their way. But whatever happens, that's the power-based solution. And what you're going to get as a result is a win-lose outcome. And if this side loses, they don't feel very good. You don't feel very good about it. And now, let's assume everybody on this side is white, everybody on this side is black. Everybody on this side is male, everybody on this side is female. Everybody on this, etc. So now we can see that the exercise of power from a win-lose perspective, which it always is, by definition, because whatever power your opponent has is power that you don't have. Whatever that division will be, that will generate prejudgment and discrimination simply as a way of defending yourself against your own empathy and compassion, simply as a way of justifying the moral outcome of what you have done, because it isn't a moral outcome. And we have to now return a little bit to what morality is in order to get some sense of this. So what happens? People on this side leave. So, no, don't leave yet. We're going to give you rights if you stick around. What are rights? They are limitations on the exercise of power. So, what's your right? Well, the air conditioning unit will be off for 2 hours and it'll be on for 20 minutes. Okay? Meaning, you negotiate adversarially to take some power away from the other side. But you've only got the power, the rights that you're willing to fight for. And it's still win-lose. So you go to court and bring a lawsuit. Somebody wins, somebody loses. You vote, all in favor of the air conditioning being on, right? You just lost again. This side wins. And the same dynamics begin to get set up. On the other hand, if we go to the third method of resolving this dispute, which is interests, how does that work? We ask the question, why do you want it off? The answer is, we're freezing over here. So what if we bring in a space heater? What if the people on this side lend the people on this side their sweaters or coats? Why do you want it on? It's stuffy in here. Well, how about if we open a door or a window? What if we bring in a fan? Well, I want it off because it's too loud and I can't hear. What if I speak louder, use a microphone? So that we can see nobody has to freeze so that somebody else isn't stuffy. How many conflicts are like that? Thousands and thousands, an innumerable number are like that. And so what we do in conflict resolution is we search for interest-based solutions. It doesn't mean there is a clear, you know, single answer to the issue of the air conditioning unit. It means there's a complex, nuanced, negotiated answer that actually requires a collaborative form of negotiation, because it asks each person to say what's important to them and why. So that's what interests are about. So here are three interest-based definitions of politics as I see it. And you're welcome to change these however you would want. One, politics is a social problem-solving process. Great, no problem with that. Now, how do we engage in a social problem-solving process in a way that keeps the social and allows us to solve problems on a much larger scale? Well, the answer is we have to have methods for people to talk about their values, their beliefs, etc. We'll come to that in a moment. Number two, politics is a large group decision-making process. How many of you have facilitated large group decision-making processes? A bunch of you, okay? And this is a part of our skill set. We know how to do this type of work. But we basically break people down into small groups, and we have facilitators and recorders and process observers or whoever. Number three, politics is a conflict resolution process. Just directly saying, making that really clear. And now, let's bring conflict resolution skills into the political process directly. So let's take a little bit deeper look. What do you have to have in order to have a political conflict? What are the elements? And I believe there are three. First, there has to be diversity, meaning two or more distinct individuals, groups of people, each with diverse beliefs, ideas, opinions, needs, and interests. Without this, there isn't any conflict. Okay? There has to be diversity in order for there to be a conflict. No diversity, no conflict. Number two, there has to be an inequality in your ability to get your beliefs and ideas and opinions implemented. Some people get theirs implemented and others do not. So now we can begin to see that oftentimes people who are liberals or on the left want to eliminate political conflict by increasing equality. And people on the right often want to eliminate political conflict by decreasing diversity. That is, by creating a set of uniform ideas and beliefs that everybody is going to go along with. Your hand is not up. No, okay. So, but there's a final piece, because these first two we can understand, but it's the third element that is our point of entry into the redesigning of this process in a preventative direction. That is, the presence of an adversarial win-lose process for deciding whose beliefs and values and ideas get implemented and whose do not. And that is what politics is, essentially. It is a win-lose process. That can be voting. Voting is a very advanced way of doing it, and we should not take voting for granted any more than we take the Constitution for granted. These are not things that we should just assume, as we have, I think, for many, many years. We just have thought that we've been moving forward on issues of race and gender and all of these things. But in point of fact, we have actually begun moving backwards. But in my view, it's a backwards motion that is triggered by the fact that we are already winning, which is very different from another type of backward motion, which is where really the whole project is up for grabs. We'll come back to that. So without the win-lose adversarial process, the conflicts would not be as polarizing. How do we do this? We create dialogue. And dialogue is one of the, what I consider to be, higher order skills that is required for democracy to work. Now, here's where Plato comes in. I don't think I have anything. Oh, yeah, so I did talk about that one. Okay, so let's mention Plato. Oh, we're running out of time, aren't we? Okay, so let me just mention what Plato says, because it's really important. Plato's basic critique of democracy is that it is the one form of government that uniquely gives rise to authoritarianism and dictatorship. And the question is why? And here is my answer as a mediator to why. Plato gives a slightly different answer, but it's the same, essentially. And that is that there are too many unresolved conflicts taking place within society so that people become upset and anxious about the level of political violence which begins to emerge in conversation. And whenever there is a threat of violence, people go for somebody safe. They will go for a dictator. And so it is a way for authoritarianism to plant the seeds that will undermine democracy by simply creating conflicts and not resolving them, so that people become frustrated and go to a strong leader. So I don't believe that this is a necessary outcome of democracy, but here's what I do believe. I do believe that it creates a perfect little intersection between politics and conflict resolution. Because now, if we can design preventative systems that actually channel political conflicts in the same way that we channel organizational conflicts in the direction of a set of processes and methods and engagements and conversations that bring people together into the same conversation, as difficult as this is, and it is difficult, it is not an easy thing to do, as I think everybody here knows. But if we can do that, then what happens is democracy clearly works, and people prefer it because they like to be included. But I do believe that there are higher order skills that are required for democracy to work. And what authoritarianism does is to dismantle those skills first in the family, and then in political discourse, and then in organizations. And it spreads. so that it becomes very difficult to have a political democracy when you have an organizational autocracy, when you have a family that is patriarchal and dominated by fear, when you have an economy in which people are, some people are in group and other people are out group, or however you want to describe it, haves and have nots. But here's the place where this actually becomes mandatory for us to do something about. We all know about climate change. This is a fundamental transformation of the planet that we are living through. And this is probably more serious than nuclear warfare because of the devastation that it is going to cause. And what is it going to do? It's going to create hundreds of millions of refugees, especially from Africa, where the Sahara Desert is going to triple in size. You can see already how big it is on the map. Imagine it tripling in size, imagining the disappearance of entire countries. There's a wonderful Somali poet whose name is Warshan Shiri. And I quote her in the book. She wrote a poem where she says, you know, very poetically, of course, nobody leaves their country unless their country has turned into the mouth of a shark, and proceeds to describe how what the immigrant style is. But here's fundamentally what it is. Democracy is a commitment to all of us doing things together, to our larger human family. And as soon as we make exceptions and say, oh, these people, but not these ones, we have lost that sense of family. And the whole effort is to try to prejudice us against members of our family. These are rapists. These are criminals. These are bad hombres. You know, all of the kind of language that we see. But fundamentally, it does not mean that there is going to be anything easy about tackling this issue. This is probably the biggest one we're going to have to tackle because it has ramifications everywhere. And we can see those ramifications, I think, right now. We can begin to see them around the world as people begin jockeying for this belongs to us. That's what nationalism means. It means this is ours, not yours. The hell with you, essentially. Now, how is this going to impact us? Within a matter of decades, probably within 40 years, maybe 50 years, certainly predicted by the end of the century, but I think it's going to happen faster than that. Boulder will have the climate of Dallas. Okay? That's what it means. Dallas will have the climate of Mexico City. Whole swaths of the U.S. will be unlivable. There will be no water in Los Angeles. What's going to happen to all those people? Where are they going to go? Same place you would go, to Canada, right? But they're going to build a fence too to keep us out. And now, is that how we want to live? Naomi Klein, who's a really brilliant writer about these issues, describes this as climate barbarism. But it begins with how we treat each other. And as soon as we make a little exception and say, oh, well, we don't really mean them, then we've lost this sense of family that we need to hold on to. So there's a lot more in there, and I didn't really end up talking much about one piece that I just want to mention to you. It is conflict resolution systems design. It's a whole field. And if you want to know more about it, I've written a book that Robin has also published, Conflict Revolution, which is about that, but also a book called The Dance of Opposites, which has several big sections on systems design. It's really worth looking at, and it is the way that you get to look at what are the sources of conflict, where do they come from, and what do we do to move in a preventative direction. So I'm thinking that perhaps people would like to have something to eat, and if you would like to do that, I will entertain. I will stay here and answer any questions, or we can all move together into the food area, and I'd be very happy to answer any questions. Sorry to have taken so much time on this. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. A question now.
If you're willing to take questions.
Yes.
I would be curious of your perception of, I think another major impact we're experiencing in our world is the mental health crisis
yes.
that we're having. And when I hear about higher levels of dialogue and higher levels of democracy and those skills we need, it appears to me that we'd also need to have a very healthy mind to be able to stay in those spaces when we're feeling unsafe and we're challenged. And so I'm curious as to your opinions or ideas around how we navigate that.
Yes.
When we want to move masses of people towards these spaces, and we're also dealing with the highest level of mental health issues that we've ever experienced.
Yes. Thank you for your question. It's a very good question. And there are when I say that these are complex issues, I mean, you know, any effort to simplify them beyond a certain point becomes the wrong thing to do. Einstein said, make everything as simple as possible, but no simpler.
Yeah.
So here is one approach to mental health. The first thing to recognize is that conflict has an impact on mental health. It drives people nuts. Conflicts inside families, conflicts in societies. And mental health problems go up with unemployment, and they go down with full employment. We know these sorts of things happen. Number two is there was a period in the 1970s when mental institutions were kind of shut down and people were pushed out onto the street. And now in Los Angeles and San Francisco, there are huge numbers of homeless people who are basically treated as, many of whom are in fact having mental problems, but are not given the kind of support that they need. On the way here, I read this morning in a taxi cab an article in the Los Angeles Times about ways in which parts of the Los Angeles Unified School District are now handling disciplinary problems involving kids who have mental problems in their classrooms. And they used to just suspend them and kick them out. And now what they're doing is they're giving them tasks to do that feel useful, and that they're building relationships with them by asking them what's going on with them. Have they eaten? Did they get any sleep last night? And not suspending them from school or sending them to the principal's office where they just sit and do nothing. Instead, there is an active engagement with the person. And what is required is a kind of recognition that this is a huge social problem. It is like racism in the sense that we live with it every day and we become, kind of accustomed to it. There are low levels of antagonism that we feel. People now working in Los Angeles City Hall were saying, we don't feel safe walking through the streets anymore to get to work. And of course they don't. This is a major problem. But we have to approach it, I think, with lots of resources available and recognize that we should not be treating other human beings this way. To me, that's kind of fundamental. But in terms of how exactly that works, I don't have a strong answer for that. Thank you.
At the highest level, so.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Hungry? Okay. Thank you. I'll continue. And, yes, thank you very much. Thank you.